else is maybe tag team. Has anyone been in the last two consecutive meetings?
Todd.
Yeah, Todd, all right.
Who ran that?
Oh, yeah, one, I didn't run two.
Did we have one in June?
No, we didn't.
Yes, there was one in June.
There was one? I don't think I was here.
I don't, do we have minutes for that?
Yeah, yeah, we can go.
I would love them if you could.
All right, so, so I'm gonna be a little bit behind, and I'll lean on you all to help fill in the gaps. But we usually start with public comment, and there is no members of the public here to comment. So we're gonna go straight to approving previous minutes. And so everyone has them in front of them, and we're looking at our minutes. Clarification, so page two of the minutes, we're under significant tree ordinance. The quoted part, that is, these are the words of the mayor?
That's the email that I was...
That was sent to...
From the mayor.
Oh, oh, okay, I see. So this is the mayor speaking?
Yes, and that's because I read the whole letter.
Ah.
And I read it.
Ah, okay, I see. So was this his reaction to our comments to him?
No.
No.
No, this was his initial, these other proposed changes. And this is the reason why I bring the change.
Thank you.
Under, on the third page, tree was handed Rob, person who blocked us. Rob said Lily received an email from Paige that requested no new or planting without planting.
Where are you, Jen?
Third page. Under tree Northampton, Rob...
Yeah, do you want me to explain that, or...
Just can you, I...
The language is not clear?
Yeah, I just was...
Lily received an email from Paige that requested no new, okay, no more, maybe the word more...
Oh, no more.
No more new plantings.
Yeah.
At CDH, it should say at CDH.
Yeah, that's what I thought it referred to, I just wanted a little more clarification.
Thank you, Jen.
Cooley Dickinson Hospital.
Did he say it at the time?
It's CDH.
Oh, then, okay, well then I would like to clarify that that's what the email said.
Okay.
The email was specifically in reference to Cooley Dickinson Hospital.
Right, yeah, and that was the discussion I think, I remember.
I mean, she also requested, okay, for clarification, she also requested that why tree belts be held off on planting until there were planting plans associated with them. So, but for certain, she was asking about Cooley Dickinson Hospital. And that, I guess that means...
Yeah, I think it was the switch in the words.
Oh, okay. And just FYI, I responded to Paige saying, I'm happy to put this on the agenda. I said, I'm not empowered to say we can do that, but I'm happy to put on the agenda for discussion.
through the list ourselves?
Literally.
And remember what to do?
Yeah.
I think it'd be better to do it at the end of the meeting.
Well, at the end of the meeting, we summarize the new things that go on that list.
Oh.
But, you know, if you're not used to going on that list, then this is definitely dedicated time to do that. That's why. I know I've gone on there occasionally and gone, wow, I forgot about that.
Well, I'd rather personally just get the reminder, like when the call to meeting goes out, and not have to bring my, I don't want to have to bring my computer here. You know, it's heavy, it's bigger than yours. Sometimes I ride my bike and it's a little bit.
Okay, I'm going to just put the link to it when Senator Jim Ward. Okay. Do others agree with that?
Sure. Yeah, that would be great.
Okay. I'm just thinking.
Yeah, that would be really helpful.
We've shaved 5 minutes off our agenda.
Yeah.
No arguments there.
Woo-hoo.
Okay, chair report. I've been pretty absent for a while, so I don't have a lot to report, except that everyone knows that Jay has offered his resignation, that he works very far from Northampton now, and he's finding it increasingly difficult to make the meetings and to do the work that he felt like he wanted to do as a member of the commission. So, darn it, I actually put together a thank you card for him, and I forgot to bring it up. So the next time we meet, I'll have everybody sign it. But I would like to send something to acknowledge our thanks for Jay. All right, so what that means is that we have a vacancy on the commission. And maybe during your report, you can let us know if there are any, if there have been any applications submitted. And is there a, want to take a moment now to think of if there are any individuals we want to recruit specifically, or encourage to apply. It's not a matter of recruiting because we don't have any control over the selection.
I do know, I did read in the paper that C.L. Frank is turning their business over to Margaret's, and he's kind of retiring. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking, like, oh, it would be helpful to have an arborist.
Yeah.
You know, a certified arborist.
Yeah, that would be good.
So I don't know him at all. Do you know him?
Is he a friend? Who's Frank?
I got a letter in the mail today about it. Planting a tree work done.
Kevin Wiedemeyer?
I think that's who it was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, I don't know if he lives around yet.
Oh, yeah.
The mayor's office, I sent them
Well, not only for us, they should just do it for the region, say, if there's a running every whatever day, they post a list of every open position that the cities are starting to fill.
I don't know this person individually, but I know of this person, and I don't even know his name. He runs a business here in Northampton, I believe he resides in Northampton, and his largest business is called Tree Cycle. I think he lives on Lincoln or somewhere in that neighborhood.
I know those guys. I forget their name. Brian is one of them.
Okay.
And what's the other guy's name? And Mike. second that one.
All right, that's going to go under other business.
Okay, I'll mention it at our next Tree Northampton meeting.
Okay.
In a few weeks.
In the meantime, you know how to navigate to the application?
Yeah, I'm on the website.
Yeah.
So you should absolutely submit an application?
I'll change all the new times, so.
I'll do it for you.
Terry, you'll be that much more alert, though. 5 o'clock, aren't you guys, like, isn't that snoodle time for you? You get up at like 4 in the morning, you guys.
4:30, yes. I recall.
Snoodle.
All right, I'm going to move on from Chair's report. I think we've got some good ideas. We'll find out the name of the Smith Arborist Tree Cycle. Would any one person like to approach? If not, I will. But if Sue, you want to?
I'll bring it up at our meeting. I know Rob and Alicia know him much better.
Well, I do want to mention that we need to move with some alacrity on this, because when we're down to 6, we still have to fill a quorum as if we're 7.
Right.
So that means if 3 of us miss a meeting, we have no meeting.
What's the quorum? 4?
4.
5?
Quorum, the quorum is 4, even if we're 6. Quorum still, what the maximum is. So if your meeting isn't too sweet, then I think either call directly or I'll be helping. I mean, at the very least, I think we should invite you to a meeting.
There's Craig, Brian, and Marie.
Craig, that's right.
Craig is the one.
Right, he's the blonde one, and Brian is the...
What's his last name?
Yeah. You know, that's what I've been hunting for here on the website.
Craig.
Part of my trip report is to talk about setback and land.
be in the gutter.
Well, these are the three arborists that you should contact.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think what's important is that it is time consuming, but I think it's been really good. And I think the more signs we put out, the more phone calls we're going to get. And, you know, we're going to be at the point where we could be doing 50 setbacks in a year. And, you know, and I've been trying to sell people two trees, a pair. I want to continue that black line. And then eventually, when we eventually get to the street, and we can do planting in the tree belt, we can actually match what's in the yard. It's kind of hard to do a planting plan for individual setbacks, but if people want to host two trees, then maybe we should do it. But the other big question is, of course, elderly stuff. Now, forever our question. Get a signed agreement. pin oaks there that I've been monitoring for a long time. They had a lot of damage in 2011 due to the storm, the fall snowstorm we had. They also have compromised root systems, although I'm asking UMass to come out and do sonic tomography on them, just like we did at Forbes. And if it's borderline, I mean, I really got to investigate the data, and then I got to get into the canopy and kind of look and see what's going on. One of them definitely needs to come down, and
so much more flexibility, right? I mean, I think that the bare root ones are also a good idea, but you have way less window of, like, you can't, like, something happens and you can't plant them within a little short period of time. They're more perishable, let me put it that way.
So BJ is, you know, he's, so we're, I'm gonna get some more background information from him. I'd like to try to put a presentation together at some point, probably in the fall or winter, just to kind of give you a taste of what they're doing.
That'd be cool.
How much it costs, you know, is it plausible that we could actually start in Northampton, Northampton as one or two plots?
We have two plots.
Two plots.
We have an area of the community gardens that they sponsor us, and they even, you know, help us some, and that's our vision, our dream, is that we could scale up in having available stock that we develop, and then suggest a donation for people to sliding scale.
I do want to thank you.
Thank you all.
Anybody have any other questions?
Thank you, that's
good. So Todd, do you want to talk about this? You guys can sit at the table.
Okay.
We feel more comfortable when I'm here. We're just, that significant tree and is now in rapid decline because of the parking lot that impacted its system and its ability to hydrate. And so I'm wondering, Todd, if there's any way to also reference that as a weakness of the ordinance, that it doesn't protect, ironically, city trees that are not technically MGL shade trees.
It doesn't. The significant tree ordinance does not protect public shade trees.
Right.
Period.
It doesn't. But it's supposed to, I mean, like, I think its intent is to protect those trees that have public value that aren't protected under MGL 87. And because that tree is neither protected by MGL 87 or the significant tree ordinance as it now is written, it's a hole that we should somehow find a way to fill. And the question is, can it be filled with suggested language change in the significant tree ordinance?
No, I think it gets filled.
Because the whole permitting, because it doesn't fall under permitting.
Well, it's a city project and it's a public shade tree. Right, it's a city project.
It's a city project, but it's not the true definition of a public shade tree. It is a shade tree on public property because it's in a park. So,
and even more weirdly, it was in kind of under the academy's purview, right? Because
yes.
The academy is
the board of trustees of the academy actually maintain the. They have a say in what happens to the building and the ground. So, in order for that piece of work to happen in the back, that has to be by the trustees. So it's very, that tree, I agree with you, just fell in a strange hole. But don't forget the other thing too, is that by actually having the tree planting guidelines, tree selection and planting guidelines that we have, that document actually will be incorporated in everything that we do. So every contractor that's working, whether it's for the city or working for an individual entity on city property, whether it's public shade trees or trees that are in public parks that I'm responsible for as a tree warden or whoever it may be, those trees will be protected by those guidelines. That's really, we didn't have those at that time.
Does that include heavy vehicles, location of heavy vehicles?
Well, what it does is it forces them, depending upon the type of construction that's going to happen, it forces them to actually put chain link fence on it. It actually forces them to put bark mulch inside of there. It forces them to air spade. After they're done with the construction and actually replace with organic matter of some sort to actually reduce the compaction. They did air spray that tree, but that tree has just been tap on tap like forever. Always something has been up against the tree. But that's not the point.
Okay, so I don't want to take us too far off, but I just want to see if there was an opportunity in Todd's work to find a way to incorporate trees like that.
The only way that would be incorporated is if that project was under site plan review. That's the way that the significant tree, that's what triggers the significant tree. But I agree with Todd, and after a conversation with Carolyn about the project on South Street, that the trees that are actually going to be impacted that are not inside the project are outside of the project will be adversely impacted by the park. Carolyn and I have sent a
routine planting spreadsheet that Molly created.
Well, that was very simple, and you all got it in your emails. I entered all the data. It was really quick because a lot of it was repetitive, so I just copied it in. I'm happy to do the previous years. We were originally going to send those to Maryland too.
Would that be possible?
Oh wait, you're ready.
Everyone knows Madeline?
Yes.
Molly was saying she'd be happy to make another spreadsheet, similar spreadsheet for the previous year.
Right. Marilyn had volunteered to do that, but I'm happy to do that as well, and it really doesn't take that long.
I know that I went to Treekeeper and tried to search for trees that were planted in 2017. There is not a way in the view, at least that I could find, in the view only version of Treekeeper to do that. I don't think the public has a project section. I think that's an admin thing. So in the absence of that, it would be helpful for us to know what trees were planted.
Yeah. You can also, because it's on an Excel type sheet, you'll be able to figure out certain things, sort of like how many lindens were planted, how many went to the different wards in the different years, whatever.
And that would have been Google Drive.
Yes. Yeah. Yep. And you should have a link to it. You have to share.
One question I had is just syncing that with what our plan was for the year and seeing how we're comparing to what we had hoped to do when it comes to a number of things, when it comes to trees planted per ward. Like I noticed that at least the only information we have is for 2018, and in 2018 it looked like we had done a preponderance of planting in Ward 3, but I didn't see any planting in Ward 7. And it may be that it averages out over time, but for example, Rich, when you do your set plat request, that's something that might inform you, is to know that Ward 3 has been well taken care of in 2017. More requests for Ward 3 can be brought to further years, and let's try to reach out or at least be more prioritized plantings. And then one of the things I was curious about was how you felt the work that Marilyn, Molly, and I did with proposing planting sites. How was that meshing with what you're able to actually do?
I
help with that plan, maybe.
Okay.
So 800 times five.
So the level of, yeah, the level of detail would be basically how many trees we're looking to plant in every, any given calendar year. So for example, you know, we do a five-year plan on vehicles, which is, you know, vehicles are static. So you can actually watch them, you know, start to rot, start to fall apart. So you can say that the vehicle's going to last, pickup truck lasts about 7 to 10 years. So we look at the fleet and figure out how long the vehicle has left, and then we kind of stick it in the capital plan. Trees are a little different, so.
So maybe the three of us will meet with you and talk a little bit more about that. You know, that leads to the third bullet, which is the subcommittee's really starting to meet on a regular basis.
Can I get just on the capital plan?
Yep.
Trees are one piece of capital. Are there any other capital pieces that your department needs to fulfill the mission? In other words, whatever, watering apparatus or?
No, because we are I built the capital plan out 2 years ago, and we are going to be buying a brand new tree truck this year. So as far as equipment goes, we are right on the money with equipment replacement.
And is there a way to amend the capital plan once it's adopted by the city council?
Yes, so what you can do is, wherever the money source comes from, so if it's a general fund, we're talking about general fund money, or bonded money, we can actually purchase, so say we have $50,000 and we wanted to purchase this truck, but we changed our mind, we want to purchase this skid steer. We can put the truck aside for another capital year and actually purchase this skid steer. If you're using enterprise money, you have flexibility only in that enterprise fund. We don't use that, it's going to be all general fund, bonded money. So you can do it. The nice thing about capital money is, as well, is that you can be rolled over. So whatever you don't spend this year can actually be rolled over, because it is, you know, it's money that will be bonded. So as soon as the bond gets pulled, the city has to make the debt payment, just like you pay the mortgage.
Yeah. Okay.
Would it be a place that we could have money set aside for like sidewalk piece removed? Like, if, let's say we wanted to plant Florence, that could be part of our 5-year plan. We're going to do Florence 5 years from now, but we need to remove X number of sidewalk pieces and backfill with like sea soil or something.
And that would also be a like larger question to also involve the planning department, because there are always moving parts in regards to that. So for example, Main Street's a good example of that. That's probably 5 to 7 years away.
Awesome. There might be a way we could get trees on Pleasant Street.
Correct. You know, correct. In the short term, because Pleasant Street basically, the corridor of Pleasant Street is done.
Right.
They're going to just do a known overlay of Pleasant Street this year, and basically what you'll see is what we're going to have for the next 15 years. As far as I can tell, I don't see that project's going to be number one. So we could actually go back and revisit that project and actually look at the hardscape and try to adjust it.
Do you have the sidewalk inventory document?
No, I don't have it. It's in engineering. I have not seen it. And I don't know where it stands in the queue. I know there's been money made available through capital improvements to do inventory, but I don't know if there's been capital. I don't know.
No, it's been done. They walked around town.
No, I understand that, but I don't know what the plan is, how they're implementing it. I haven't got that for it.
Yeah, we should.
Yeah, that's going to make, that'll be huge. That'll have a huge impact. A lot of trees.
Okay. Last thing, just about the reviewing the trees that we proposed versus the trees that were planted, and that is, would be helpful for us to propose a greater number of sites so that when we can't meet our highest priority sites, you have a next tier to go down to.
Yes. The only thing that concerns me is
are at the point where we can quickly move the content that we have fleshed out pretty well at the last meeting to the website. I know that the city was undergoing some website changes. Is that, is Karen, because if Karen's ready to work with me, I can work with her on getting all that content.
If you, I mean, Karen will be able to work with you, I just talked about a bunch of things, but she would have to do it.
Because you'd like to see that as soon as possible.
I would like to see it as soon as possible, because if we're gonna, we want to actually, I think our discussed in the past is trying to capture some applicants this winter.
Yep.
So we actually have the ability to review them over the winter and select them based on the criteria that we set forth, and then actually tell them, okay, on this date, on September 1st, whatever, maybe this will be applied to the program, it's not an issue.
And just to be clear, we're doing a pilot this fall.
Yes.
Oh.
Or Orchard.
Oh, that's what I was just about to ask about. What's the status of the Orchard pilot thing?
Okay, well, Paige was gonna be my content person, you know that?
Oh, gosh. Yes. We haven't talked about this in a long time.
Yes, no, we haven't talked about it in a long time. But, so we're adopting this new type of planting project where we reach out to a neighborhood, or eventually a neighborhood applies online and is selected because they meet some criteria, some of which is loose and some of which is strict. And, you know, has good volunteer base, has identified trees that are either set back or on the tree belt, sites for planting, and, you know, just has a lot of robust neighborhood energy around doing this project together, including potentially having a neighborhood pop up on the day of the planting. So we wanted to start small, sort of in-house, and so we wanted to test a neighborhood going through this process of filling out the online application to give us feedback, like this worked or this was confusing and that sort of thing. And then carrying out the project with us on a maybe smaller than typical scale. And so that when we roll it out to the broader public, it's gone through a little bit of a, you know, dry run. So that's what we're hoping to do this fall with the neighborhood. It doesn't have to be strictly Orchard Street, but it could be the neighborhood around Orchard Street. Having said that, I am aware that Ward 3 has really been well treed this year. I mean, I'm looking at the spreadsheet, I can see that Ward 3 is. So, I mean, if this guy in Prospect is like ready to go.
He's just waiting for an email.
You know, and if you're like, I mean, I'll do it if nobody else will do it, but.
That's kind of how I feel. Do it if nobody else will. I mean, the thought of organizing a potluck and all of that kind of feels like.
The potluck is absolutely mandatory.
That's straight criteria.
Three or four people.
We're talking, you know, you're talking about this robust neighborhood, this action, and I kind of feel like, I'm not sure that exists.
Okay.
You know, there are a few people who like trees. They like that the trees get planted.
Yeah.
Some of them. There are some who don't.
Right.
I'm willing to do some.
Do you want to get out of jail free right now?
What's this guy on Prospect Street?
All right. So what?
Yeah, he's a judge.
He's a judge.
So my judge. Work role to get out free jail.
That's fine.
The only problem with if we decide to shake it up is that we've already committed the first two ginkgos.
Oh, the ginkgos were going to go on Orchard? We don't have to have
Are
ginkgos.
They going on the inside the cemetery, or are they going on Orchard?
On Orchard.
Yes. On the tree belt.
No, I mean, we're going to do it a world.
But that tree belt is like this wide.
Okay.
All right, then you know what? I think that let's. I want to go back to plan one. Don't worry about a potluck, Paige. Let's just.
Paige, we can get Domino's.
Let's do this pilot. I'll be there to support you. I'm an expert person.
You are. You're the one who is funding all this.
Well,
it's part of this, the money that
same,
you raised.
It's the same thing. I need to get rid of this money.
15 years later.
All right, so we're good with that. I'll work with Paige.
And does it have to be ginkgos?
It's their order.
Okay.
We can
could wait, you could do the guy on Prospect, Pinko's on Prospect.
You can't, yeah, there's, I wanna wear a dress.
Okay, all right.
We'll do it.
Okay, I'm gonna get us back on our schedule, so thank you everybody for the update, and we're moving on to tree sweep.
Okay, hello everyone.
Hi.
My name's Madeline Lawfarn, I'm her daughter. So I met you guys earlier this spring to talk about, to propose my project, and now I'm a month and a half into the internship at Smith. And I've chosen my 5 trees to pilot, and three of them are in Plasky Park, a London plane tree, a American linden, and a tulip tree, the tulip poplar. And then I chose the champion pin oak on Columbus, and then the gorgeous American elm by Palm Street, as my other two great Northampton trees. Mm. And I've written 5 scripts about them, and they're being ended at Smith. And right now I'm in communication with Karen to talk about what the sites would look like. And
the website.
The website, yeah.
Oh.
And Rich.
Yeah.
Rich, yep. Yeah. We're talking.
Reached out to the mayor.
Yep.
Yeah, the mayor and Don are both on board there. Try to sell the same deal with QR codes to the folks that are going to do some loan aggregation. Because I think it's actually.
Wait, can you speak up a little
bit? So, at the beginning, we had a bridge. I met with, it's a whole other story, but Bridgeford Cemetery in the process of actually writing an RFP to actually prepare priority stones 1 and 2 that have been damaged. We got a $50,000 grant.
Attaching at some point, the physical attachment. the next item is planting near Coley Dickinson Hospital. Do you want to give us a little, do you want us to give you a little history?
Sure. And then I could just do a very brief introduction of where I went when I heard that this was being planted.
But sure.
I'm really happy to hear what you all have going.
Okay, so this will be brief. And that is that, so Molly Marilyn, another tree commissioner, and I are part of this subcommittee that tries to identify promising sites around the city for doing some planting. And one of the focuses, foci, we have are around community centers. You know, like whether it be a schoolyard or a senior center or Coley Dickinson Hospital. So it came up as a really promising site. And we did a preliminary walk through there with Rich, and it was a real back of the envelope kind of tally. We realized there were a ton of trees that we planted there, that it's almost like a blank slate. And then we had another walk through with the, or we reached out to the appropriate grounds person there, and he was enthusiastic about the idea of planting, and we did another walk through with him. And so then, you know, he said, give us a plan. And so that's kind of where we're at, is that we did come up with a really kind of etched in stone plan. We came up with a, like, this could support probably 12 large trees and 3 small ones. And then a little wrinkle in it was the city, we found out, we checked in with Wayne's office, this is the Wayne's Biden, and learned that they were going to be putting in a bike pad there, right at the bus stop. And so we weren't quite sure how that was going to potentially conflict with our planting, especially if they were going to have solar panels on it, you know, to help electrify the bike. So it was around this time, and before we've submitted anything formal to Coley Dickinson, that you said, hey, folks, I heard you're doing this. You know, here's another step. So maybe that's where you want to
go. Yes. So I heard that there was the idea of float to plant at this incredible spot. You know, it as you suggest, it's really quite barren right now. And this is right at the gateway to Northampton. And it's such a broad space. This isn't your average tree belt. And then the other opportunity that's there is that there's this parking lot. And at present, the parking lot is graded in such a way that it goes directly into the storm sewer. And you know how the city has this priority. Anytime they redo streets, they look for places where they can do bioswales from the street. And so I just felt like, ooh, wouldn't this be a great opportunity here? And so I met with John O. Niger, as I mentioned in an email to you all, and he saw great potential for that. And he is one of the principals, as is Sebastian Goodwine, of Regenerative Design Group out of Greenfield. And so here is Bosch.
So yeah, John O.'s they couldn't make it. And so I just wanted to come and speak. You know, Paige, someone who always sees opportunities, she's amazing that way. And I just wanted to speak to, you know, we know that this is beyond your, a lot of this stuff, a lot of blue language is totally beyond your purview, but you, now that you have, now that a crack has been made into this area, you know, it's possible to start talking about, okay, trees, that's wonderful. What else are the opportunities there? And if you're already having started this conversation, how can you expand it and say, like, okay, maybe this would be a great place for an infiltration, some sort of infiltration infrastructure that comes from the hospital. They have the space there. It seems like the elevations would work, etc. What about other, you know, mini parklet opportunities there? What about, you know, pollinator habitat there, etc. And so I think that I'm here to just say thinking about the other possibilities here. There's potentially a lot of opportunities, but I'm happy to help you think about that.
In your work on this project, so it's been Molly and you, and Marilyn's not here right now.
Yeah, and actually, our work was just to really identify the site.
Uh-huh.
Then we pass it on to folks who do the more detailed work, and that was Jay, Jen, and Rich.
Yeah.
Jay, Jen, and Rich. Because they have the more horticultural, arboriculture professional experience than me. So.
And then we were also, there's a chance for making the utilities underground or something. You would, like, so that was kind of stalled us, so.
On the tree belt section.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So we didn't want to, like, go in here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. If they were going to, we're floating underground, so I don't know what that is.
And then there's also a long-term wish of them. I don't know if you can visualize this, but separating the parking lot from the street is this long line of forsythia and
junipers.
The junipers. And they would be happy to see those replaced with something else, including shade trees to help provide shade to the
wow.
So, I mean, but
you
this
scored.
Is like, there's a short-term
that's awesome.
And a long-term. Yeah, so I do think that there is promise to back up, say, hold on, time out. There's maybe we need to be looking at this through a different lens than just the narrow lens of shade trees. And, you know, maybe you are the folks. And I don't want. I'm speaking for myself here. I don't want to speak out of line because maybe there are already things that are in motion. But if things aren't sufficiently in motion, and folks do feel like this is an opportunity, then you should probably be in direct contact with the relevant person. His name is John Lombardi at Cooley Dickinson. I don't remember him saying that there's a ton of money for this, but there might be some, and so it's worth exploring.
In terms of redesign of the parking lot, there could be grant money available through the city, possibly.
I have no idea. I know there's grant money there, and I'm sure Northampton has been very good about. Northampton is well known for being very good about their grant writing. And in Greenfield, we've done a number of grants on infiltration. And I presume Northampton would have that up there as well.
But not on private property.
Huh?
Not on private property.
Right. But could the hospital be writing a grant for that in partnership? So there's a lot of these probably nots, but you know, if the conversation gets started and you start talking to the right people, all of a sudden you realize that, oh, actually there is an opportunity here. There's a lot of probably nots, but all you need is one yes, and you can go forward. So
it would be an expense for the hospital, and it may be a no-go situation. It, you know, may be that the hospital just says, we like our parking lot, we like utilizing the storm sewer system as it is and having our, you know, subscribing to the away paradigm that water can flow away and be taken care of elsewhere rather than being infiltrated and used to nourish these very trees that you've been thinking about planting.
Does the hospital pay the stormwater fee? And is there any mechanism for that to be reduced / waived in exchange for green infrastructure? Construction.
Is there only answer to that question?
My understanding is that there's a small incentive to putting in, reducing your
permeable surface.
Yeah. And the infiltration is, you know, the amount of water that you're infiltrating on the site. But my experience also is that it ends up being almost nothing.
Yeah, that's my understanding.
Yeah. You know, what's compelling to this site for me is, you're bringing up the stormwater issue, which I hadn't even considered. What's more compelling for me is that it's a hospital location. by the pool.
Yeah.
And that, you know, study after study has demonstrated that people that look out on green space, they have more sense of optimism, like, you know, better healing rates. And even better if they can walk out of the hospital for a little bit of green time. I think that's why I feel like this is such a golden opportunity for the hospital. Right now, the face of the hospital is very ugly. It's very ugly. I mean, I just call a spade a spade. And it should be the opposite. I mean, it should be a place where healing takes place.
And I believe that could be an argument that the hospital might be interested in hearing. That they're really an eyesore in this city, right at the gateway of Northampton, and that these, you know, the confluence of the tree commission and this possible redesign of the parking lot could result in a really beautiful front of the hospital. So anyway, so you suggest a contact, you know, us contacting this person.
Well, before I do that, I just want to make sure I hear from other commissioners to see what their reactions, thoughts are. Because sometimes I put my opinions out there and I don't want it to be the only,
yeah,
only voice at the table.
I mean, you always say that, like, we are, like, public shade tree, you know, so it's a little out of our purview to go, even though I agree with what you're talking about as a sustainable, you know, landscape or something like that, you know, it's a little out of our purview to venture into the parking lot situation.
The tree commission would be doing the tree part. You know, this
maybe. Because one of the things, sorry to interrupt you, one of the things you have to remember is that the only way that we can provide trees to Cleveland is in hospitals through the setback plan.
That's right. Right.
And that means they have to have the agreement between the tree warden and the trustees of the hospital.
So, and the city solicitor being cool with that?
Yes, we already have a form and I filed the information for registry. Work on their property with the 20-foot right away. We can provide them trees as part of either just a tree planting plan or as a larger part of a much larger plan that would be sold by someone else, not by this commission, supported by this commission, but not sold by this commission. So our role and my role as a tree warden is really only to work with the hospital or one of the representatives saying that he has to provide them with trees. Looking at the hospital.
I personally support what you're aiming for, because I agree with it. You know, to plant trees would be fantastic, but to actually have a nice landscape to plant these trees, and capture all the things you're talking about, actually would be really beautiful. Again, that's really about dollars and cents. I think the best way is to contact someone, if you could have someone actually put a design together, you know, a conceptual design, and actually show them, okay, this is what we're talking about. Because I kind of felt in our conversations with John that, you know, conceptually for him, it was very easy to actually see, you know, think about trees. We never really talked about actually having the landscape work or anything. But I think that in order to make that happen, tile a piece together and have a conceptual.
I'm also a professor at the, I teach at the Conway School, newly part of Northampton.
Right.
Anything I will be in there. And so they, you know, that is a potential if there is the need for a plan. I don't know if it works for the, you know, $500 fall, or, you know, one student for the fall semester. It might be the right scale for that.
That's a great idea.
If you're at the bus shelter, probably maybe a foot or two beyond the sidewalk is public property. If you go past the bus shelter going towards downtown Northampton, which you cross over, the city owns that large tree belt. There was a whole bunch of land takings that happened when they redesigned that intersection. So the city used to own actually more property than it does presently. But they gave the hospital ability to have a property build their parking lot, and also for the city to re-tree that intersection. That intersection, if I remember, was very dear.
Yeah, there used to be a big tree there.
There was a very large tree there, yes. There was lots of stop signs, lots of accidents.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that's why originally one of the things I was trying to do after looking at this project was actually trying to work the national grid. You know, we use national grid for basically, you know, line clearance, but I also utilize local arborists to get a lot of trees removed. So one of my thoughts was to utilize national grid to get the utility wire buried and ask them to partner with us to actually get the utility wire buried, hopefully on their dime.
They may have no interest in, they just want to go for it.
Might get kicked right back.
Thank you.
Appreciate you showing up. Okay, onward, tree, Northampton.
Hey, thank you for all your work.
Yeah.
Amazing, amazing tree commission.
Take care, thanks, bye you all.
Thank you.
Thank you. Soon is planting season, so a lot of work has been going on with Alicia and Rob, being the pavement, and planning, working with Rich on all the many calls up from the signs. Have you folks seen the signs around?
Yeah, you mentioned that earlier.
Yeah, used to go home.
Yeah.
So that's, tree Northampton has been involved in that, and you know, it's really very clear on the sign, just get in touch with Rich, they are, a lot of people are coming through tree Northampton. Which is fine, but can help facilitate and happy to do so. So we're, August meeting coming up, we're really gonna look through the planning plan in detail for the fall, and what has been, things that have been lining up over the course of quite a few seasons and setbacks that folks have been working on. So I haven't been directly involved in that, so I know a lot's been going on, and a lot of planning to come. And hopefully we'll start having some dates for getting volunteers set up and organized on it. Plus, there was a real solid Wednesday group and a Saturday group, and then Rob was out getting some planting somewhere with one person.
Based around something that we
what would it actually take to do it right, like in a downtown setting? I think, you know, that and the sidewalk component are possible additions that we can use with a capital planning process, where we say our base is this, and we want to be able to do some demonstration, you know, do it right projects to show them, you know, how you actually grow a healthy urban forestry environment in our downtown settings. Because, well, you know, as you know, we're not going to get very far with the current situation. We're just going to wait for, you know, Main Street to be redone. You're all.
I know, but, you know, one of the, but my, and I like that, it just triggered something in my head. We have a whole bunch of vacant sites on Main Street. Some have stumps in them. So my recommendation would be, as part of a capital plan, that we would actually look through those areas and say, okay, if we're going to, FY20, we're going to pull all those stumps out. And we're going to remove the hardscape. And we're going to actually install structural soil and then the planting, correct planting medium, and then adjust the hardscape and then plant all the shade trees. So that would be like larger, long-range capital projects. I personally would be afraid, given the way that our weather has been, that if we don't replant Main Street, you're going to, I mean, there's two other trees that have to come down on Main Street. There's another oak on the corner of Center and Main that's got a top that's dead. And they're all struggling, and they're really basically outgrown their ability to grow. Sure. Where they,
yep,
they're 30 years old, 40 years old. I think maybe my question would be to the mayor, is exactly what type of capital planning are you looking to get from us? Are you just wanting a number? Do you want actual projects? Because really, when we do capital planning for replacement of equipment or structures, you know, we are basically saying we're going to replace this piece of equipment because it has expired. Its life has expired. Its life has expired. Now it's costing us more money to maintain it. The same thing can be said for a tree, but, you know, a tree could be fine in the spring and then by the end of the summer, it could be dead. So,
yeah, I think it'd be good to know what he wants, but I think we have the tools at our disposal, especially the inventory, to pretty much back up every claim that we make. Use that inventory, say there's, you know, 20 vacant and at-risk sites downtown, and each site's going to take whatever to do it right, and that's our downtown money there. You know, we can add to the basic.
You could also do the same thing for Pleasant Street, because Pleasant Street really would be a good, because Pleasant Street's done. Mm-hmm. So we could actually go back in there and say, okay, all these trees that they planted have failed.
Yeah. So, example, for
and so we want to replace these trees, but they're going to...
Very too deep.
Yeah, they're going to, you know, each tree pit cost is X. And we're going to plan on doing this in FY20, right? You know, FY20 next year.
Do those trees that are failing, do they pay for those to be replaced? There's no.
They're out of their warranty period.
In some ways, it's good. All right. We're in the other. Yeah.
Is there anything to report about? Last time you talked about Cumberland Farms having to redo their planting in Florence, but it doesn't look like they've done anything.
No, they actually, so the final agreement is that Cumberland Farms actually has to remove a bunch of sidewalk because it was installed improperly. They also have to repair the pedestrian bump out they have there because that has to be all ripped out and done over.
Huh, really?
Yeah, because what they did is they left the granite at this site, the sidewalk was right into the granite, so it's a trip hazard.
Oh.
It should also make the northern entrance exit only, because if you take a left to get in there, no one can get around it because you got the pedestrian bump out.
So with that said, they actually are going to take all the hardscape off where the trees are in the area where the sidewalk is not pitched properly. They're going to excavate all the gravel that's in there. They're going to put all the structural soil that's supposed to be in there. At the same time, they're going to actually lift those trees up because 3 out of the 6 or 4 out of the 6 are planted.
It was a very contentious meeting. We met in the back room of Cumberland Farms with all the, you know, we met with East Construction, we met with the primaries, with the contractor, we met with the architect, landscape architect, and, you know, they were city engineer. I mean, I took the city engineer, and I went and had a little conversation, we came back with this, what needs to be done. We're not gonna accept any of this, and that's just the way it is. There are emissions with this as well. So really, it was actually a really good, it was a good combination of all the forces that we have, like, so look, this, I'm not gonna accept this project, it's not correct.
Yes.
So.
Kudos to the Department of Cooperation, this conversation, it's a challenge.
Well, and that, and just the awareness that, you know, the larger knowledge that Karen Lynch got and the engineer got, I mean, that's like, you know, pebbles in the pond where, you know, so, it's pretty, very significant, not just the cooperation, but like, oh, right, you know, this is where it has to be.
You know, and the other thing too is that we had, there's a landscape architect office across the street.
Yeah, that's.
Yes, and they were watching out their window.
Oh, they were the ones who told you about it in the first place, right?
They sent me emails.
Yeah.
No kidding?
Yeah.
Right.
Good, good, okay.
So it's really, it's
a wearing house anymore.
Yeah.
Isn't there some plastic rings in those? Like, what is it?
Yeah, that, well, we're supposed to put flexi pave in there.
Oh, that's why they were there, okay.
Right, but they're not doing that.
I'm like, what is that? Yeah, got it, yeah.
One other item that I think of every time I pass by King Street, so I can either try to cram it into other business or put it on the agenda next time. And that is the volcano mulching along King Street on public shade trees is getting worse and worse and worse. And I feel like it's now a demonstration project that, you know, people may drive by and think, oh, that's how I mulch a tree. And so I'm wondering if we need to enlist an army of volunteers to demulchify those and create signs that say volcano mulching kills trees. And use that, I mean, like, that's such a visible corridor there. And
it's big.
Undo the damage before those trees die, but also use it as an education piece because thousands of cars drive by that area. So I wanted to throw that out there as a possible project that maybe volunteers could help with.
Yes, we've already been talking about this a certain amount, about how to best approach to get the best outcome for that. We have a lot of volunteers who have trained in volcano mulch removal.
Right.
It is in discussion.
It's in discussion.
Between Northampton and.
Awesome.
I love the idea of putting up a sign.
I would propose, just like we have free trees to good homes.
Free mulch to good homes. Take the
mulch.
Exactly. Extra.
I think we could say good trees need good homes or something like that, you know. But I think there's a messaging thing.
It's, if you've ever gone in where Bay State Health has their offices, it extends into there.
Yeah,
right. Yeah, totally.
So,
I might
put that on.
I ride my bike up there.
It's just gotten so in your face.
Every time
and
I see
it. And it's on our trees. It's not like it's on their private trees. It's on our city trees. So that's what feels personal.
How did that happen? Did they plant our city trees?
Yeah, I mean, what happens is, I think when those developments happen, the city extracted an exchange that they plant trees along the tree belt.
Oh.
And they planted trees improperly, and they contracted them.
I guess we need to, when we say you need to plant trees, we've got to be really specific. How to do it.
This is why we have. So we are much better prepared now than we were before.
Yeah.
So this kind of thing won't happen. I have to find out who the primary owner is. So really the right way to do it would be to actually send the primary owners of the property a certified letter. You've got 14 days to take it off. If you don't take it off there in 14 days after receiving the letter, then I'm going to do it and I'm going to send you a bill. If you don't pay the bill, then we're going to do it. We're going to end up actually putting the property. That's how you typically
to the shitty landscaper that's doing this, you know, on an isolated level, but if we can just educate, I think we're winning the sure way.
Can we do a sign? Like, I love the idea of having, this is, yep, yes and no, or something like that.
Right,
next to the tree. Mm-hmm. Or, I don't know.
I want a door hanger.
Yeah, we have a ton of door hangers. We could turn one of them very easily into a, you know, into a, like a political sign, like the good trees do, or free trees do. The way those march along in front of the Gazette, they really catch your eye because there's a whole series of them.
Plus you got them on Prospect, or what is it, Elm Street?
Elm Street, Bridge Street.
Yeah, I mean, it's really, it's very catchy.
It is catchy, it's drummed up, you call them everywhere.
Yeah, it's great. And people know some of those bags.
Other towns, really? Hey, got some trees for us in Goshen.
All right, let's go around and do, and recap what we need to do, each of us individually. Molly, should we start?
Well, I would love to do more of the, do you have any lists, any more lists like this from previous years? And also.
Probably, I'll have to find.
As you go along in 2018, are you gonna keep sending me, you know, things to update with?
When the list is finalized, I'll send you another. That, you can send you a list of where most plantings are, but that's not the actual as-built part.
Well, if you send me another list, can you make it so it doesn't include these on it? Otherwise, I won't know which ones are new and which ones are old. Okay. Thank you, Molly.
Okay, and then Molly, will you take the initiative to suggest a meeting time for Marilyn and me?
I'll amend the comments for Marilyn and the May. Get together with Rob and Jim for a plan and a plan and meeting.
I will nod and Rob when that happens, and I have to come up with a page about tree that I was going to have for Rich for the tree about suggested options, like better, best, okay, better, best, like bags are better than containers, and this is more hours.
Usual laundry list.
I have.
It's too long to imagine.
I will actually, Todd, you're going to send me that before you send that to Carolyn. Will you send me, please, after you change, make the correct additions.
Yeah, whoever you want, however it is.
Yes, you send it to me, and then I'll review it, and then I'll forward it to Carolyn, and I'll see you soon.
Terry reminded me that I was going to mention changing the meeting time. Is this urgent? Do we want to urgently move it back to 4 o'clock? Or should we cut this down? We urgently want to move. Okay,
yes.
Let's make a motion.
Motion.
I would second that.
Okay, so let me just clarify. Yes. We're in discussion.
So you might want to actually just meet, have our next meeting at 5 and get the other two commissioners to make sure that they are all on board. Or if you want to communicate with them directly, send an email out and say that. Project content to Karen. You want to see it first, you want to view it first. So Rich,